A signal fault, the most likely cause of India's deadliest train disaster in decades. With almost 300 people killed, hopes of finding loved ones fade as the rescue operation ends. Also tonight, ministers warn Boris Johnson he could lose taxpayer-funded legal help in the row over his evidence to the COVID inquiry. And... he danced his way to the final, but after overcoming cancer, will Musa Mosar be crowned winner of Britain's Got Talent?
This is ITV News with Kylie Pentelow.
Good evening. The worst train disaster in decades in India was most likely to have been caused by an error with a rail signal. Almost 300 people died and more than 1,000 were injured in the crash involving two passenger trains and a stationary freight train. India's railway board said there had been some kind of signalling interference. Our Asia correspondent Debbie Edward has the latest.
The mangled carriages stacked in a ditch at the side of the train tracks, and the diggers already starting to repair the damage, indicated the rescue operation in Odisha was over. A search for survivors overnight had recovered only more bodies. The intensive care unit at this hospital was overwhelmed with critical patients. Hundreds arrived, many with life-changing injuries. Jyoti Pashwan was returning home with his wife and son. His boy is still missing. Like many on board, these four friends were on their way to Chennai to find work. Mukesh Pandit got trapped in the overhead luggage rack and believes that saved his life. Railway officials have not ruled out sabotage as a potential cause of the crash. They confirmed a signalling error sent the Coromandel Express onto the wrong track, leading it to smash into a stationary goods train at full speed.
What we have found is that there is probability of some kind of a signalling, signalling interference.
The horror of this crash is borne out by the pictures on this table. Almost 300 families received a call to identify their relatives at the morgue. They queued to match images of their loved ones in life with an official photo taken of them in death. What a truly devastating process to endure. The government was due to launch a new high-speed rail service this weekend. It has pledged to improve India's railways, which serve 13 million people every day. But instead of speed, passengers are again calling for greater safety. As the country comes to terms with its worst rail disaster this century. Debbie Edward, ITV News.
Back home, and Boris Johnson has been warned he will lose his taxpayer-funded legal advice for the COVID inquiry if he undermines the government's position or releases evidence to it without permission. The government's currently taking the inquiry to court, challenging the evidence it's asked for. Well, for more on this, our political correspondent David Wood has joined me. So, David, some of Mr Johnson's supporters seeing this as a cynical move by the government.
Yes, they're suggesting that some of the evidence that's released could be embarrassing for Rishi Sunak and his team, although the government insists tonight that it has nothing to hide. Now, the government's been ordered to hand over a number of messages, WhatsApp and otherwise, between senior ministers, including the current and former prime ministers and officials. But what Downing Street prosecutors and the government is arguing is that they should redact the stuff that's not relevant to the COVID inquiry. That's what this whole legal dispute is all about. And while that legal tension between government and inquiry happens, Boris Johnson has said, well, he can hand over his WhatsApp messages directly to the inquiry if need be. That's where we get this warning about, well, if you're not following government advice, why would taxpayers foot the bill for your legal bills? Earlier, I spoke to one senior minister who said this isn't about restricting what Mr. Johnson can do.
The former Prime Minister is at liberty to hand over whatever documents he wants to the inquiry. What we have said is that as he's being represented by lawyers paid for by the taxpayer, that that needs to be done appropriately, as you'd expect when you're using public funds.
Allies of Boris Johnson say they'll be able to help with legal fees if he does lose the taxpayer-funded legal teams. But there are murmurings on the backbenches about what could be embarrassing for Rishi Sunak. Suggestions that the Eat Out to Help Out scheme, which subsidised meals in the summer of 2020, well, that some scientists have already said that contributed to a spike in COVID cases, so there could be information around that. Even some suggestions that a plot to oust Boris Johnson could come to light. Now, Downing Street sources saying all of that is total nonsense and that there were no plots. Whatever the final decision in this, I think what's difficult for Rishi Sunak is we're seeing increasing tensions now between Team Johnson and Team Sunak. And for all politicians, what I think is difficult is WhatsApp really how government decisions can be made? Can you separate the personal and the professional on WhatsApp? The courts will decide.
Okay, David Wood, thank you very much. The teenager who died following the Bournemouth beach tragedy has been named. He was 17-year-old Joe Abbas, who was a trainee chef. In a statement, his family said, "We're heartbroken and devastated at the death of our Joe. He was a wonderful son and brother who is sadly missed." They go on to say his family and friends will always love him, and we are incredibly proud of the fabulous young man he was. He was kind and generous, loving and caring, hardworking and funny. And a man has been charged for allegedly wearing a shirt to the FA Cup final, which appeared to mock the 97 people who died in the Hillsborough disaster. James White, who's 33, has been charged with displaying threatening or abusive writing. On to sport, and Max Verstappen's domination of the Formula One season shows no signs of slowing after victory at the Spanish Grand Prix. But the British contingent are getting quicker, with Lewis Hamilton and George Russell both taking places on the podium. Here's Chris Scudder.
Who could stop Verstappen? Answer, not Lando Norris. Third on the grid, but then disaster on the first corner.
Hamilton and Norris make contact!
The Brit's front wing was damaged, and second lap repairs meant Norris's hopes of a podium finish were wrecked before he'd barely started. But Hamilton escaped unscathed, and his once almost unbeatable Mercedes was in second place, slowly but surely getting more competitive again. And if George Russell has lived in Hamilton's shadow, George made his bid for a podium with a classy overtake into third place.
Solid work.
Just solid.
It was pretty good.
George Russell!
And the good news was he also hung on to it, holding off Sergio Perez for the podium finish. Up ahead, though, a familiar sight. V for victory, Verstappen as usual, three wins in a row, five in the first seven races, and another world title looks a formality already. But at least the Brits are on the up with two Mercedes outnumbering the Red Bulls on the podium. Chris Scudder, ITV News.
And finally, after weeks of show-stopping songs, incredible dances, and even Ant McPartlin taking a tumble on stage, the latest series of Britain's Got Talent comes to an end tonight. In just over an hour, the finalists will take to the stage to try to win over the public for the last time. Ravina Gattura reports now on the hopefuls looking for fame and fortune.
He's not only danced his way into the Britain's Got Talent final, but into the hearts of the nation. After losing his leg to cancer at 11 years old, Musa Mota's story is one of defiance and determination. He made history after receiving the first ever group golden buzzer, and now he's a bookie's favourite to win tonight's show, but not the only dancer hoping to take top spot.
We are the Ghetto Kids from Uganda, Africa, and we like to move it!
Ugandan group Ghetto Kids won over the judges with their magical moves. After growing up on the streets of Kampala, they found joy in dancing and together want to inspire others back in their home country. and also hoping to win over the public once again is Amy Liu. At the salon where she works in Tipton, there's plenty of pride in her success.
Obviously, I'm really, really proud, but I've been proud of her since the day I was born, not just because of BGT. If you ask my daughter, they'll say it's a cliche, but she was literally singing before she could walk properly.
The winner of tonight's final will perform at the Royal Variety Show later this year.
Can I do it just one?
No.
But first, they need to impress the public one more time. Ravina Gatora, ITV News.
And that's it for now. I'll be back, though, with the late news. That's after Britain's Got Talent, just after 10. But from all of us here, have a lovely evening. Bye-bye.
Today we'll see warmer temperatures moving in from the east, especially around tea time. Heinz Beans sponsors ITV National Weather.
Hello there, very good evening to you. What a gorgeous weekend of weather for most of the UK. And as we look ahead to this evening and overnight, it continues to be a very settled picture. High pressure firmly in control of our weather at the moment. It continues to be so for the foreseeable future. Now, we are going to be seeing more in the way of the low cloud just floating in there from the North Sea, covering much of East Anglia into the Midlands as well, generally down the eastern fringes. And that is going to give a fairly slow start to tomorrow. So if you wake up and see the cloud, don't worry, it will burn off. But it will take its time as it burns off down towards the coast, hangs in there for some into the afternoon. Always those northern and eastern fringes hanging on to rather more cloud. The best sunshine definitely more across the central and western parts. Absolutely gorgeous once again. Temperatures rising up to a very pleasant 23 Celsius, 73 in Fahrenheit. And we continue to see a very similar story for the rest of the working week. That's it. See you later.
Heinz Beans sponsors ITV National Weather.